Macbeth shall be king hereafter.
Welcome to this guide for Shakespeare's Macbeth. On screen at present, then, is a user's guide for how to use this resource. Please pause this to learn perhaps the best way of using this guide to support your studies. Today's video is going to focus on the witches. As normal, we're going to focus on the two assessment criteria for Macbeth. That's AO1, understanding what the play is about, and AO2, its language, its form, and structure. You can see there the royal family and the hierarchy in Macbeth, Scotland. Duncan, of course, is at the top as King of Scotland, followed by his sons and then the nobility, Macbeth and Macduff included. Under them you have Banquo, and then lastly you have characters like Fleance and young Seward, the sons of some of the minor characters. The witches are separate, of course, to this. They have their own hierarchy. They have Hecate, or Hecate, queen of the witches. And then you have the three weird sisters who serve Hecate. With any character in Macbeth, it's important to study the chain of being, that is the hierarchy of everything at the time. If you're unsure of what the chain of being is, please pause the video and read the information through there. And we need to know where the witches fit in on that. Well, the witches are outside of the chain of being and are expected to deliberately disrupt it. When the witches appear in the play, the audience would know they're there to cause chaos and deliberately change the chain of being to something more unnatural. Bit of context then to understand why the witches are in the play and a bit about their background. Well, James I, King James, who was on the throne at the time of Shakespeare's writing, loved a good witch hunt. After learning about them abroad, he even believed he was nearly killed by them at sea. This is something Shakespeare references at the beginning of the play. James even wrote a whole book on the subject in 1597. This was called Demonology. A copy can be seen on the right-hand side. Shakespeare had to get patronage from James I. Patronage means where you have to basically get your wages from the king in order to keep your theatre open and run your plays. And of course, after Queen Elizabeth I died, Shakespeare used Macbeth as a way of appealing to the new Scottish king. James's book, Demonology, was released just before Shakespeare wrote Macbeth, and so helped Shakespeare form the characters of the witches, combining this with his other source, Holinshed's Chronicles, which gave him information on Macbeth and King Duncan. Let's learn a bit more then about witch hunting or witches in Shakespeare's day.
There was a time in our history when an epidemic of hysteria spread amongst primarily Catholic and Protestant communities. In the early 16th century, mass executions became an all too common theme with the rising outbreaks of witchcraft accusations. The roots of supernatural beliefs are found in both popular and elite culture. According to the webpage Assortment, in 1515, authorities in Geneva, Switzerland burned 500 witches at the stake. In 1526, in Italy, there were 1,000 witch executions. In 1571, witch hunts swept across France after claims were made of over 100,000 witches roaming the country. Over the 160-year period, from 1500 to 1660, an estimated 50,000 to 80,000 suspected witches were executed, including about 26,000 in Germany and 10,000 in France. Witchcraft reached its peak during the late 16th and early 17th century throughout Europe. The idea of witches and witchcraft was inspired by male hatred for and sexual fear of women, which occurred at a time when women were struggling for independence. Men had reason to prosecute witches in an attempt to control improper behavior of women. The Reformation perpetuated panics by ridiculing traditional church defenses against the devil and demons, compelling people to guard themselves against evil. Attacking accused witches became a way for the church to extend its spiritual authority. Any tragedy, such as illness, cattle death, or fruitless labor, seemed to become punishments for their breach of charity, and they turned on poorer neighbors, accusing them of witchcraft as revenge. Witch hunts were not only destabilizing, but threatened total anarchy. An explanation for witchcraft beliefs could be a lack of education amongst the common folk. However, witchcraft belief was also prevalent among more elite classes. There were those in popular society that believed that witchcraft was not just traditional beliefs, but actual practices that invoked real magic. In 1692, in Salem, Massachusetts, the Puritan community believed that a woman is more likely to fall victim to witchcraft than a man. Women were naturally lusted after and were presumed to desire sexual relations with the devil. Puritans believed that witches could tempt other individuals into participating in witchcraft and were concerned with Satan and his influence on the earth. They held theatrical pretrial hearings in an attempt to prove witchcraft through viable evidence in the Salem courthouse. The Salem witch trials began with King James's fear of witches. He was known to believe that witches were a tangible representation of the devil. In the end, more than 200 people were accused of taking part in witchcraft, and 20 were executed.
So how do the witches tie in with the key themes you might be asked about? Well, fate and free will. Well, fairly easy one that. The witches take away Macbeth's free will and tell him his fate or destiny. They link then to Macbeth's ambition. It's them that give him the idea that killing the king and becoming king himself was a good idea. The witches are the most powerful characters in the play, and they present Macbeth with different versions of reality. They tell him what could be in his future. They're gender non-specific. They're described as being bearded, as well as clearly being half female. They're the second biggest supernatural force in the play. Arguably, Hecate or even Banquo's ghost be a little bit above them. They promote Macbeth to commit more acts of violence, although he is indeed violent already. And to the witches, time means nothing. They're almost outside of time, as if they're not really subjected to natural law. Some key ideas about the witches. They seem to be quite masculine in their approach. They're unearthly. They united against Macbeth. They are proud of their achievements and seem to enjoy taunting the king. They're credible. In other words, what they say can be believed. And they're scheming. They seem to spend a lot of time plotting against their enemies. What does Shakespeare want us to remember the witches for? Well, of course, it was the witches who told Macbeth he'd become king, and without them there would be no play. In the stage direction, in Macbeth and Banquo's words, we find out they're described as weird sisters, hags, instruments of darkness, bearded hags, withered and wild, and imperfect speakers. Shakespeare deliberately makes the weird sisters into strange, wild hags who love causing mischief. They are seen to be unnatural and deliberately unsexed, either male or female, or genderless, thereby escaping gender stereotypes around at the time. They are deliberately presented by Shakespeare as puppeteers of the play who control Macbeth's actions through their imperfect speech. They draw upon the evil inside their victims and encourage them to self-destruct. That is why they are instruments of darkness rather than the devil himself. Here's a picture then of Holinstead's Chronicles, one of the key sources Shakespeare used to create Macbeth. Shakespeare used Holinshed's Chronicles, which is a half-made-up history of the British Isles, to give him an idea of the basic storyline for Macbeth, but in this text, the witches were nymphs and fairies, not agents of the devil. The creatures in the original text were symbolic of youth and beauty, and the Anglo-Saxon word weird was used to describe these creatures and suggest that the creatures were able to predict someone's fate and or destiny. Shakespeare actually took this idea and converted it into witches, something he knew King James cared about. Shakespeare exaggerates the witch-like qualities of the characters, so they would immediately link to James I's book, as well as controversy around witches at the time.
So for most of European history, and indeed for most of world history, people believed in unseen powers that operated across their world and in their individual lives. Objects from nature could be healing or poisonous, working in unknown ways. Like Queen Elizabeth once received a ring that was supposed to protect her from the plague. Most towns had a shaman, or a wise man or woman, or a wizard, or a sorcerer, or some other resident who knew about potions and poultices and charms. And look, Queen Elizabeth never got the plague, so it was easy to conclude that sometimes, at least, this stuff worked. As one bishop wrote in 1552, when we be in trouble or sickness or lose anything, we run hither and thither to witches or sorcerers whom we call wise men, seeking aid and comfort at their hands. Otherwise, men could use eclipses or sunspots or comets or other natural phenomena to predict momentous future events, like earthquake tremors in Istanbul in 1648, for instance, were said to foretell the murder of the Sultan 2 months later. All these shamans and special healers and fortune tellers were widely depicted in the many books now streaming from the printing press, with stories that often strayed from reality. The reading public seemed to revel in tales of witches, their special witches' rites, their antics and adventures, their sexual perversions, and their attacks on and corruption of the innocent.
But Shakespeare also didn't want to scare his audience too much, so he made the witches caricatures to help create an eerie atmosphere in the play.
Mary, move your wings! The doors! Are they locked and bolted?
Locked and bolted.
No.
As you can see, the boy in the clip is more amazed than he is scared. I think this is the reaction Shakespeare would have wanted. Just like the picture on the screen at the moment, the witches in the play are over-exaggerated. Yes, they're scary, yes, they're eerie, but they're also a little bit too classically witchy to be totally believable. What do the witches in the play represent? Well, Shakespeare challenges us to explore the idea of destiny. Is it the witches or Macbeth himself who is to blame for Duncan's murder? He challenges us to think about the supernatural and its impact on us as human beings. And he challenges us to confront the idea that power can corrupt you through the Macbeth's corruption by the witches. The first time they appear then is in Act 1, Scene 1. The witches set an eerie atmosphere in the play. They laugh at the wars of man. The witches plan to meet Macbeth, and the witches are called by their familiars. Shakespeare has the witches resemble the fates of Greek mythology. We are not told exactly how powerful they are at this point. Let's have a look at how the witches might appear on stage.
When shall we three meet again? In thunder? Lightning and rain.
When the hurly-burly is done, when the battle's lost and won,
that will be ere the set of sun.
Where the place? Upon the heath.
There to meet with?
Macbeth.
Let's have a close look at how the witches speak in this scene. Well, Shakespeare unites the witches as a team. Shakespeare gives us the image of a united force of evil that will face Macbeth. It also appears the witches are continuing a scene that's already begun, implying to us the play is part of a much larger chain of events. Shakespeare has the witches use childlike language to describe war with Norway. It is as if they're observing two children playing. Shakespeare challenges us to accept the witches are more powerful than trivial human matters and don't care who wins, who loses. This also foreshadows the play, as although Duncan wins, he also loses. Because Macbeth wins the fight, he goes on to kill Duncan. Shakespeare uses sibilance here, that is a repeated S sound, to make the witches appear sly and devious, a technique later used by Lady Macbeth. Shakespeare references the witches' familiars here. A grey malkin is a grey cat, and a paddock is a toad. The witches are obeying these animals as if they are the masters, the opposite of what we might expect, which challenges us to see the witches' world is not the one of reality. Everyday rules are made to be broken by these witches. Let's look at a really great quote from this early part of the play. Fair is foul and foul is fair, hover through the fog and fill the air. Shakespeare has the witches chant this line to emphasise this is a supernatural play and create suspense by using spell-like language. The phrase fair is foul is repeated and suggests to us that what is fair or acceptable to mankind is foul and disgusting to the witches. This is then reversed as what is foul and disgusting to man is fair and right to the witches. They juxtapose the natural order. The phrase fair is foul is a deliberate reference to the plot of the play and Macbeth as a character. Shakespeare confronts us with a fair man at the start of the play, but soon has him act as foul as we could imagine. The words fair and foul are repeated by Macbeth and Banquo later in Act 1, Scene 3, which suggests to us that Macbeth and Banquo are already under the witch's spell. So fair and foul a day I have not seen. The fog and filth suggest to us the mysterious atmosphere of the play, but also suggest the battle nearby, as does the thunder mentioned in the stage direction. You're just about to see three productions of that scene. In each of them, the director has taken one element of Shakespeare's play and used it to help the actors interpret the witches. These three then are very different, and as you watch, please look at the thought bubbles on the left-hand side.
When shall we three meet again? In thunder, lightning, or in rain?
When the hurly-burly's done, when the battle's lost and won.
That would be ere the set of sun
were the place
upon the heath
there to meet with Macbeth.
And the second example.
Battles lost and won.
That will be ere the set of sun.
Where the place?
Upon the heath,
there to meet with.
And example number three.
I cannot tell. No, my gaseous cries.
So well thy words become thee as thy wounds. They smack of honor both. Go, oh, get him, surgeons!
Shall we three meet again in thunder, lightning, or in rain?
When the hurly-burly's done, when the battle's lost and won.
That'll be ere the set of sun.
Where the place?
Upon the heath.
There to meet with
Macbeth.
Fair is foul,
and foul is fair.
Hover through the fog and filthy air.
Fair, fair is foul, and foul is fair. Hover through the fog and filthy air.
Those three interpretations together, and that gives you plenty of alternative interpretations to mention in the exam. Let's look at some key quotes then. I spent time to pause the video and make some notes around these. They next appear in Act 1, Scene 3. The witches awake Macbeth and discuss the cruelty that they inflicted on a sea captain whose wife insulted them. The witches tell Macbeth two predictions. He will be Thane of Cawdor and he will be king. And they follow that up with a third prediction when they tell Banquo that he shall get kings. Macbeth wants to know more, but the witches vanish. Throughout this scene, repeated reference is made to the number three by the witches. Three witches, three prophecies, thrice to thine. This is likely Shakespeare referencing the Holy Trinity, but in this case, a very powerful unholy trinity. Let's have a look at then at their conversation with Macbeth.
Where hast thou been, sister?
Thy swine, sister? Where thou?
A sailor's wife, a chestnut in her lap. I'm munched and munched and munched. of me, could I? A righty witch, a rump-fed runyon cried. Her husband's to Aleppo gone, master of the tiger. But in a sieve I'll thither sail, and like a rat without a tail, I'll do. Sleep shall never night nor day hang upon his penthouse lids. Weary 7 nights, 9 times 9, shall he dwindle, peak and pine. Though his bark cannot be lost, yet it shall be tempest-tossed liquid a half.
Show me.
Here I have a pilot's thumb, right this homewards he did come.
A drum!
Macbeth doth come.
Royal sisters, hand in hand, posters of the sea and land, thus to go about, thrice to thine, thrice to mind, thrice again to make up nine. Peace!
The charm's wound up.
So foul and fair a day I have not seen.
How far is called to Forres? What are these? So withered and so wild in their attire that look not like the inhabitants of the earth and yet are armed. Live you? Or are you aught that man may question? And you seem to understand me by each at once her choppy finger laying upon her skinny lips. You should be women. Yet your beards forbid me to interpret that you are so.
Speak if you can. What are you?
All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, then of glams.
All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, Thane of Cawdor.
All hail, Macbeth, that shalt be king hereafter.
Good sir, why do you start and seem to fear things that do sound so fair? In the name of truth, are you fantastical, or that indeed which outwardly you show? My noble partner you greet with present grace, and great prediction of noble having and of royal hope that he seems rapt withal. To me you speak not. If you can look into the seeds of time and say which grain will grow and which will not, speak then to me, who neither beg nor fear your favors nor your hate.
Hail. Lesser than Macbeth, and greater.
Not so happy, yet much happier.
Thou shalt get kings, though thou be none. So all hail Macbeth and Banquo.
Banquo and Macbeth, all hail.
Stay, you imperfect speakers, tell me more. By my father's death, I know I'm Thane of Glamis. But how of Cawdor? The Thane of Cawdor lives a prosperous gentleman, and to be king stands not within the prospect of belief, no more than to be Cawdor. Say from whence you have this strange intelligence, and why upon this blasted heath you stop our way with such prophetic greeting. Speak! I charge you!
Once more then, let's look a little closer at the language being used. Simplistically, Shakespeare makes the witches sound primitive, but they also don't care for nature and are seemingly pagans, killing animals for sacrifice. This could contrast with Lady Macbeth, who kills her own child in the next couple of scenes. Shakespeare has the witches speak in both rhyming couplets and trochaic metre, which makes the sound both mesmerising and mysterious. In addition, it also confronts us with the idea that witches are childlike and playing games with their victims. Shakespeare forces us to see the witches as petty and childish, as they get revenge for something as simplistic as not giving someone chestnuts. The other witches want to help. This exaggerates the idea they're toying with Macbeth later in the play. Shakespeare then confronts us with the evil depths the witches will sink to over such a trivial crime. This foreshadows Macbeth's own demise, as he too is drained of his moral values, as they describe the pilot as being to drain him dry as hay. We also know the witches stop the pilot sleeping. Macbeth suffers the same fate. Oh, Macbeth shall sleep no more, and Lady Macbeth, to bed, to bed, to bed. It seems the witches particularly love depriving people of sleep when they're deliberately trying to ruin their future. Shakespeare challenges us with characters who are both mischievous and deadly, as the witches show, as the witch shows a cut-off body part to show the shocking conclusion of the pilot's story. Shakespeare has Macbeth repeat the same language as the witches, which challenges us to see the witches as already hiding Macbeth under their spell. This also implies his belief in witches. The oxymoron here is deliberately confusing. Shakespeare has Banquo immediately question how supernatural and demonic the witches are. He emphasises how unidentifiable the witches are and don't conform to the stereotypes of the era. Shakespeare has the witches ignore the rudeness of Macbeth and tell him the prophecies. They hail him, implying to us that he is powerful, which manipulates him through his ego. Shakespeare suggests to us the rational nature of Banquo compared to the more spiritual Macbeth. Banquo is more respectful of the witches, which may suggest why he gets a more hopeful outcome. Shakespeare has the witches only hail Banquo. They don't use his name as they did Macbeth, implying to us their sense of mischief as they don't quite show the same respect to Banquo as they did his friend. Shakespeare deliberately contrasts Banquo with Macbeth, as the atmosphere is deliberately mysterious and the oxymorons deliberately create a sense of the supernatural. Shakespeare has Macbeth plead with the witches to give him more detail, which implies to us that Macbeth's character is weakened as he's desperate to know more. He becomes more desperate the more he talks. Some key quotes then from this scene. Once more, pause the video, make a note of a couple of them, brainstorm around the outside. They next appear in Act 3, Scene 5. This is where Hecate tells the witches off for speaking to Macbeth. Hecate instructs the witches to tell Macbeth of his destiny, and Hecate promises to use magic to ruin the overconfident Macbeth. In many respects, this is the forgotten scene. Try finding this one in a version of the play on YouTube. Hecate is the queen of the witches and simply served to show the chain of being is bigger than the play defines. Many critics think this scene actually wasn't written by Shakespeare at all, but was added later, as one of the actors might have wanted a more expanded role than he actually got. We're now going to listen to Hecate's speech then.
Have I not reason, beldams, as you are, saucy and overbold? How did you dare to trade and traffic with Macbeth in riddles and affairs of death? And I, the mistress of your charms, the close contriver of all harms, was never called to bear my part or show the glory of our art. And which is worse, all you have done has been but for a wayward son, spiteful and wrathful, who, as others do, loves for his own ends, not for you. But make amends now, get you gone, and at the pit of Acheron meet me in the morning. Thither he will come to know his destiny. Your vessels and your spells provide your charms and everything beside. I am for the air. This night I'll spend unto a dismal and a fatal end. Great business must be wrought ere noon. Upon the corner of the moon there hangs a vaporous drop profound. I'll catch it ere it come to ground, and that, distilled by magic sleights, shall raise such artificial sprites as by the strength of their illusion shall draw him on to his confusion. He shall spurn fate, scorn death, and bear his hopes above wisdom, grace, and fear. And you all know, security is mortal's chiefest enemy. Hark, I am called. My little spirit, see, sits in a foggy cloud and stays for me.
Hecate is queen of the witches and began life with one of the Greek gods, queen of the underworld. She is known to see the future as well as the past. She is often represented as an older woman, but also appears as a beautiful young woman, so time means little to her. She is known to have cared for those that were unjustly treated, perhaps like Macbeth. The idea of familiars also comes from legends of Hecate.
The connection between Hecate and the tropes that we've come to associate with the modern-day witch can be further strengthened by the fact that she would mostly only be seen during the evening, enjoying strolls with her companions, and sometimes even being followed by the occasional spirit or ghost. This led many to refer to Hecate as the Queen of the Night. There is even a character in Shakespeare's Macbeth named Hecate, who also happens to be the goddess of witchcraft. Although largely being seen as a protector, there were those who feared the goddess for good reasons. It was believed that she was particularly protective of those who had been shunned or oppressed. She appreciated those who were less conventional, much like her. There's no doubt that her role in the underworld, helping those prepare for their new life and adjust to unfamiliar surroundings, brought Hecate great comfort. It's hard to find any real reference as to what type of magic that Hecate may have possessed, but there have been theories and suggestions that are worth considering. With her close association to the dead, it wouldn't be a huge stretch to imagine that Hecate could physically touch ghosts and spirits, allowing them to be soothed. It seems likely that there would be a strong connection between Hecate and the dead she cared for. One can imagine, in a dire situation, she could command the dead to fight for her. But this is a power I can't see Hecate ever using, as controlling another individual would seem like something she'd be adamantly against. But given the role she played in the underworld, it's likely, similar to Hades, that she possessed some kind of authority over the dead. The gift that is most heavily alluded to is the one given to her by her mother, of prophecy and premonition, as many believe that Hecate was able to look into the future. The potential list of powers that Hecate could have possessed is almost endless, and I guess it comes down to our imagination. Hecate still appears to be honoured to this day, with some pagans and Wiccans still worshipping the god.
Once more, let's have a little bit of a closer look at this scene. Shakespeare has presented to us a supernatural power that is more powerful than the witches and appears to be more sympathetic to Macbeth. Hecate sees Macbeth as arrogant and self-centred. She is reprimanding the witches like children for being so shallow and foolish to even bother with him. Shakespeare has Hecate describe Macbeth's fate to bring to a close the witch's foolishness and restore the chain of being back to the way it should be. Hecate uses various different meters to her speech, implying a deeper sophistication to her power and thinking. Some key quotes then from this scene. Act 4, Scene 1. The witches prepare to meet Macbeth, creating a spell. An aggressive Macbeth arrives, demanding more prophecies. The witches ask him to choose who wants to hear the prophecies from, the witches or their masters. Macbeth chooses the masters. An armed head warns Macbeth of Macduff. A bloody child tells Macbeth he cannot be killed by a man of woman born. And a crowned child tells him he won't be defeated until Birnam Wood comes to Dunsinane. Macbeth wants to know more, and the witches present him with a line of kings, and at the end, Banquo's ghost. The witches laugh and vanish. This scene structure deliberately recalls the opening scenes of the play. Once more, Macbeth's destiny is in question. Once more, he receives three prophecies. Once more, he's left on his own to decide how best to interpret those prophecies. And once more, he fails to understand that fate is inevitable, however he chooses to act. Let's look at Macbeth's reactions to the witches then in this scene.
Oh.
Thrice the blended cast hath mewed. Thrice. And once the hedge pig whined.
Oh. Hark ye, cried.
This time? This time.
Round about the cauldron go. In the poisoned entrails throw, toad that under cool stone days and nights has 31, sweltered venom, sleeping god, boiler first on the charmed pot.
Secret black and midnight hags. What is it you do?
A deed without a name.
Oh, a deed without a name.
I conjure you by that which you profess. However you come to know it, answer me. Though you untie the winds and let them fight against the churches, though the yeasty waves confound and swallow navigation up, though bladed corn be lodged and trees blown down, though castles topple on their warders' heads, though palaces and pyramids do slope their heads to their foundations, though the treasure of nature's germens tumble altogether, even till destruction sicken. Answer me. Do what I ask.
Speak.
Demand.
We'll answer.
Say if thou'dst rather hear from our mouths, or from our masters.
Call them. Let me see him. Tell me, thou unknown.
He knows thy thoughts. Hear his speech, but say thou not.
Macbeth. Beware, Macduff. Beware the Thane of Fife. Dismiss me. Enough.
Thou hast helped my fears aright, but one word more.
He will not be commanded. Here's another. More potent than the first.
Macbeth.
Had I 3 ears, I'd hear thee.
Be bloody, bold, and resolute. Love to scorn the power of man. For none of woman born shall harm Macbeth.
Then live Macduff, for me no fear of thee. But yet I'll make assurance double sure, and take a bond of fate thou shalt not live. That I may tell pale-hearted fear, it lies and sleep in spite of thunder. What's this that rises like the issue of a king?
Listen, but speak not to it.
Macbeth shall never vanquished be until great Burnham Wood, high Dunsinane Hill, shall come against him.
That will never be. Who can impress the forest, bid the tree unfix his earthbound roots? Sweet old man's gut. Rebellious dead rise never till the wood of Burnham rise. And our high-placed Macbeth shall live his lease of nature, pay his breath to time and to mortal custom. Yet my heart throbs to know one thing. Tell me if your art can tell so much. Shall Banquo's issue ever reign in this kingdom?
Seek to know no more.
I will be satisfied.
Seek to know no more.
Deny me this, and an eternal curse fall on you. Let me know.
Show.
And grieve.
Once more, let's analyse this scene. Shakespeare revisits the witches here and gives us the image of witches creating a spell by having them create a stereotypical witch's brew. The ingredients are all poisonous and deadly, which foreshadows Macbeth's death. Shakespeare deliberately uses the same words as Macbeth at the end of the play, with the word charmed. Macbeth says he led a charmed life before he dies. Once again, Shakespeare's Macbeth repeat the witch's words to show he is under their spell or hypnotised by their power. Shakespeare lists the ingredients here of body parts, both human and animal. If you place these parts together, it could be interpreted as a monster. Shakespeare confronts us with what Macbeth has become due to the witch's mischief. Shakespeare develops the audience reaction further by referencing those that were discriminated at the time, Turks and Jews. This would have gotten a mixed reaction at the time Shakespeare was performing. Let's look closer then at a particular key quote. By the pricking of my thumbs, something wicked this way comes. The pricking reminds us of bloodletting and pagan ritual, challenging us to see the witches as older than time, but also implying how little effort it is to take down King Macbeth. The word thumbs is a direct reference to the beginning of the play. Remember the pilot's thumb that was cut off at the start. This suggests the end is near for Macbeth. The reference to Macbeth as a thing implies he's no longer human or less than human, which links to the monster the witch has created in the cauldron. Shakespeare deliberately juxtaposes the brave Macbeth at the start of the play with the wicked man he's become. He is now evil and corrupt. Shakespeare uses simple rhyming here, like a nursery rhyme, that is both memorable and fun. The tone is gleeful, which foreshadows the fun the witches are about to have with the arrogant Macbeth. Shakespeare builds the tension here as Macbeth's language is more abusive and rude than it was before. He insults the witches, not something they take well as we know from the start of the play. He speaks in threes, as the witches do. Shakespeare confronts us with the image of Macbeth as a witch himself. He conjures the witches to answer him. His tone and sentence structure imply he believes he is their equal. Macbeth matches the witch's power with a powerful curse of his own, demanding to have an answer, even if it requires the unleashing of all the elements of air, water, and earth. Even all the universe, natural or man-made, tumble into ruin. The abrupt nature of the witch's response implies that they are angry and seek to corrupt his moral compass and values, almost taunting him to step forward. Macbeth's most defiant act by far is the desire to hear the prophecy of his future, not from the witches, who are themselves only mediums of the supernatural, but from their masters, that is, the controlling fates. It is useful to know what each apparition might symbolise. Take a look at each as it appears. Apparition 1. The only apparition that is not a child. Macbeth is confronted by his own beheaded head as his own ghost talks to him, but is too arrogant to notice. Apparition 2. The just-born bloodied Macduff. Or is it the ghost of the baby Lady Macbeth sacrificed, that is Macbeth's own son? Or is it an image of Macbeth, Macbeth's own innocence, that's now bloodied and dead? Apparition 3 is Duncan's son Malcolm, crowned, but who soon comes to Burnham Wood and brings it to Macbeth's castle, Dunsinane. Apparition 4 is when the witches show Macbeth a line of 8 kings. This is the number of generations between Fleance and King James I. The last holds a glass, which is a magic ball or mirror. If it is a mirror, it would be used to reflect King James himself sitting in the audience. And of course, lastly, we see a smiling Banquo holding that mirror as if taunting Macbeth into the fact that, of course, it's Banquo's son Fleance who's the beginning of that long chain of kings into the future. Apart from the first, all the apparitions, including the fourth and final one of the possession of future kings, contain children. The juxtaposition of children, pictures of innocence, and images of death, warfare, and blood is dramatic and terrifying, but especially so for Macbeth. For a man who has no offspring, the image of children can only fill him with hatred and loathing. The children who appear in this procession are children of Fleance. The reflected light in their golden crowns doth sear, cut into, mine eyeballs, and causes its eyes to jump from their sockets. The climax to Macbeth's reaction occurs with the line, "What, will the line stretch out to the crack of doom?" in which he finally realises the possibility of an entirely Macbethless future. Let's look at the language in this scene. Shakespeare's Macbeth unravel at the prospect of not having a son and the destiny the witch's prophecies coming true. It is suggested to us that his former arrogance and cockiness is shattered as he shouts and yells abuse at the witches in fear. Shakespeare uses repeated rhetorical questions and short statements here to imply Macbeth's fear and shock at his fate and contemplates his future. Shakespeare juxtaposes the bloodied Banquo with the happiness the character feels as his own destiny is due to come true and knows his son will soon father a line of kings. Shakespeare allows us to reflect on the witches as makers of mischief with the positive language and tone here, as, for once, women have beaten the male-driven patriarchal society they live in. The witches confirm the inevitability of what Macbeth has seen. Aye, sir, all this is so. There can be no equivocation, no argument with fate. The simplistic nature of his statement is chilling and cold to Macbeth. Some key quotes, then, from this scene. Shakespeare presents the witches as creatures who rejected God and the chain of being, deliberately creating mayhem and enjoying themselves as they do so. They are instinctive creatures who combine the natural with the supernatural, playing with Macbeth's dreams as you would a toy. As the play progresses, Shakespeare builds the tension and slowly reveals the witch's true power and ability by making it clear that the powers that Macbeth is suffering from are not in his head, but very much in the real world. He is hypnotised or mesmerised by them. Shakespeare wants us to both fear and enjoy the witches as they almost play the heroes of the play, taking down the villain and restoring King James's bloodline. These screens then contain a shortened version of this clip, with quotes in the beginning, middle and end of the play. Pause the screen now to make notes. As the play develops, we witness brave Macbeth easily corrupted by the united supernatural forces arranged against him. By the time Macbeth commands the witches' presence a second time, they're bored. Now we turn to the part of this clip then that focuses on essay skills. This is a typical first question you might be asked, based then on his first encounter with the witches. The question you might be asked is at the top, and it's worth 15 marks.
So foul and fair a day I have not seen.
How far is call to forest? What are these? So withered and so wild in their attire, that look not like the inhabitants of the earth, and yet are armed. Live you? Or are you aught that man may question? You seem to understand me by each at once her choppy finger laying upon her skinny lips. You should be women, and yet your beards forbid me to interpret that you are so. Speak if you can. What are you?
All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, Thane of Glamis. All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, Thane of Cawdor. All hail, Macbeth. That shalt be king hereafter.
Huh? Good sir, why do you start and seem to fear things that do sound so fair? In the name of truth, are ye fantastical, or that indeed which outwardly ye show? My noble partner, you greet with present grace and great prediction of noble heading and of royal hope, that he seems rapt withal. To me, you speak not. If you can look into the seeds of time and say which grain will grow and which will not, speak then to me, who neither beg nor fear your favors nor your hate.
Banquo, hail.
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 Lesser than Macbeth. And greater.
Not so happy, yet much happier.
Thou shalt get kings, though thou be none. So all hail Macbeth and Banquo.
Banquo and Macbeth, all hail!
Stay, you imperfect speakers. Tell me more. By Sinel's death, I know I am Thane of Glamis, but how of Cawdor? The Thane of Cawdor lives, a prosperous gentleman. And to be king stands not within the prospect of belief, no more than to be Cawdor. Say from whence you owe this strange intelligence, or why upon this blasted heat you stop our way with such prophetic greeting. Speak, I charge you!
As you can immediately see then, I've split this scene into three pieces, a beginning, a middle, and an end. It seems to be Banquo who does the most speaking, which might be quite surprising, until, of course, Macbeth orders the witches to stay at the end. The lack of speech from Macbeth might well indicate how hypnotised he is, how transfixed he is on the witches. Immediately the scene starts with the repetition of the witches' language, foul and fair, and it's said as a statement, as if he's just come under the witches' spell. We then have Banquo speaking, asking a lot of questions to the witches that he doesn't give them chance to answer. He's showing his curiosity in what he sees, or maybe even his disbelief. He says, you seem to understand me, implying then that he wants to be understood by the witches and is waiting on them to respond. He describes them using choppy finger and skinny lips, which the witches might find insulting. And he also inquires that they should be women, yet your beards forbid me to interpret that you were so. Banquo is not quite as rude as Macbeth is, but he's certainly worried about what he's seeing in front of him and wondering if they are indeed human at all. He doesn't at that point, when he's accusing them of being choppy-fingered and skinny, he isn't talking exactly directly to them, more observing what he can see as if the witches at present don't really exist to Banquo. Macbeth, on the other hand, is much more spiritual and seems to believe in witches a lot more, as he then encourages them to speak by asking direct questions. As we look at the mark scheme then, 10 to 12 marks, we need to be able to look at various different things, different aspects of the character, use well-chosen direct reference to the text, and analyse writer's use of language. So from each of these sections, I'd want to choose about three quotes or so that just tell me something about the character and their reaction, as well as a quote or so that I can analyse in much more depth. Now, in the first section, obviously Banquo is going to be our main focus, but Macbeth has probably got the most interesting line, "Speak if you can, colon, what are you?" He's using imperatives. He's talking directly to them quite forcefully, "if you can." He seems to doubt whether they can indeed speak at all, which might be why he refers to them as being imperfect speakers later. And when he says, "what are you?" it's interesting the word "what" is used, implying then that he's not quite sure whether they're objects, humans or animals. The direct and forcefulness of his question implies he feels he has power over them, even at this point. Notice there, I selected a quote and began looking at individual words from it, as well as punctuation choices. The question mark and colon could both be spoken about, and then thought about what I might say about them to reveal his character and his reaction to the witches. I'd need to do the same thing for the middle and end of this extract. Common errors that I could make in writing my response were not making enough points and forgetting to make clear this is a play. That's why I've got to select more than one quote to comment on, although I may not do each quote in as much detail. And of course, I've got to keep referencing the fact there is an audience for this play and it is Shakespeare writing it. These are not real characters. They are fabrications. They are exaggerations of men that might once have existed, but these are characters in Shakespeare's play with a clear message as to why those characters are behaving the way they are, in this case, towards witches. And of course, not showing how the relationship grows, changes or develops in each part of the script. I'd want to comment on how at the start, Macbeth is making statements and then demanding the witches. In the middle, he doesn't say anything, implying he's hypnotised. And by the end, he's desperate to find out more, pleading with them as imperfect speakers to give him more information. Banquo, on the other hand, starts quite curious as to the witches and what they're doing. Then by the middle, he's more concerned with his friend's reaction, Macbeth's reaction to the witches. And by the end, it is Banquo who's gone silent, and then Macbeth doing all the speaking. Perhaps Banquo at this point is standing back, observing his friend and beginning to worry about exactly how engaged Macbeth is in the prophecies the witches have given. My essay plan might well start with a short overview of the scene, then write about the start of the extract, then what has changed by the middle of the extract, and what has changed by the end of the extract. You might ask where the start and middle and end is. Well, in the exam, you divide it up as you see fit. It's up to you. This might be then how I write my answer. Overall, Macbeth and Banquo react with curiosity at the sight of the supernatural. They are filled with adrenaline from a recent battle and are eager for more excitement. From the start, we can see the effect of the supernatural. Notice I start with a point there before I use a quote. Macbeth repeats the words of the witches by stating, "so fair and foul a day," which challenges us to see him as a man already under the witch's spell. The alliteration, "fair and foul," so foul and fair, imply his own plot in the play, a man who changes from a good to bad man. On the other hand, Banquo appears more cautious, repeatedly asking questions and being formal to the witches. Shakespeare has him call them, "not like the inhabitants of the earth," which confronts us with the image the witches are supernatural and strange. The frequent use of apostrophes implies he's hardly able to speak as he's unable to believe what he sees. In contrast, Macbeth appears a lot ruder to these clearly supernatural beings. As the extract develops, Banquo's attention turns to his friend's reaction, as he appears to care more about the human well-being than supernatural forces he cannot understand. Notice I've written one quote there and analysed it, and then I've gone on to a secondary quote and a comment on punctuation. The colour coding there implies how I might get the grade. 1B will ask you about a whole theme in the whole play. This is where you've got to remember quotes from other parts of the play to explore in more detail to show your understanding. How is the theme of the play, theme of the supernatural presented in the play as a whole? In your response, you should refer to the play as a whole and show your understanding of characters and events. Essays on this and other themes can easily be found online with a quick Google search. Something that's really useful to do, but if you're unsure what to write for a theme. But it is a starting point, not a way to get a full exam-ready answer. Often the online versions I found were really good ideas, but it's the wording of them that you might need to tinker with to make sure you can get the best from the quotes they use. Once more, I start my answer with a brief overview, then the start of the play, the middle of the play, and then the end of the play. What events could I cover? Well, it said supernatural, not just the witches, so there's lots of interesting options. I could talk about Lady Macbeth's speech, Unsex Me Here, the dagger speech by Macbeth, the scene with Banquo's ghost, and of course the apparitions at the end. I wouldn't have time to do all of these, so I'd select the ones I understand the best to write about in the actual exam. Here then is a full answer with colour coding as I might write it. Now this isn't a perfect answer, but it certainly gives you a flavour of the kind of thing you might need to write for a pass grade. Notice the colour coding. I've put in green links to the writer, my quotes are in red, and my links to the audience are then in blue. Please read it through, make notes on it, and see if you can do this from memory. My middle two paragraphs. And my last two paragraphs. Now, if you were to look at each part of this essay and then rewind this clip or play back this clip, you could add a lot more detail to the amount given here. Take this then as the basic grade 5 answer, which could easily be added to. What you might want to do then is make notes on this essay, then rewind the clip and see what extra things you can add in, then practice it to make sure you can do it in the time limit. Thank you very much then for listening to this revision guide for the Shakespeare text, Macbeth.